The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast, the penultimate episode on season three of the show. And we're getting closer to Christmas as of release date. We've still got a little bit to go in the real world here. I am joined on this edition by something a little bit different. He's wrestling in the States. He's bringing Scottish strong style to across the pond. He's one half of the distinguished noble aristocrats. It is, of course, it's Lord Murphy Costigan. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me. Appreciate it.
So thank you for joining. I know the time difference, but we had a little bit of issue trying to set this up because there was a couple other guys that are wrestling in the US that are bringing the Scottish flavor to the scene, and we were getting like, oh, it's 7 o'clock their end, 1 o'clock mine. No, definitely not recording 1 o'clock in the morning. I don't think my wife would appreciate that an awful lot, me shouting in the next room. But yeah, we've figured it out. We're here and recording. I usually ask how you got into wrestling, but we'll put that one aside for a second. How are you doing today, sir?
Oh, so far so good. Weather's nice here. It's not too cold yet. Where I live in Tennessee right now, we're starting to get into the colder season, and I would rather be cold than be hot, because if you're cold, you can just put more clothes on, but if you're hot, you can only take so much off when you're committing a crime. So far so good. Can't complain. How are you doing today, sir?
Not too bad. We're in the middle, as of recording, Storm Arwen, which... it didn't really affect me at all, but there seems to be surrounding places that have lost power. Electricity's gone. My work had to do some rerouting today so I could actually do work, which I was gutted by. I thought, that's great, I've got a day off here. Nope, not so much. They were able to figure it out. But so it's usual Scottish weather, to be honest. It's just a little bit windier. Trampolines are in different gardens. That's how it ends up being. But the first question we ask everyone, the proper one, is how'd you get to pro wrestling? What was the moment that you watched and got you hooked into it?
It's a funny story. As a child, one of my friends, he got me a video game, and it was SmackDown versus Raw. Just, it wasn't 2006, 2007, just SmackDown versus Raw. And I had no idea what it was. I had never watched wrestling in my life, so I had no clue. So I started playing. I was like, oh, this is interesting, but I didn't know really what it was. What, like the Undertaker, who's that? I don't know. I'm hitting people with chairs and the ref's getting mad at me, and I thought it was all part of the game. I went over to his house one day, and he pulled up, I want to say it was SmackDown, and it was Finlay versus Chris Benoit. And the only thing I could think was, these lads are beating the absolute chocolate out of one another. And I was hooked from then on, just how hard they were hitting each other. And even though I can't do the stuff that like guys like Chris Benoit and even Lucha guys like Rey Mysterio, I can't do the stuff that they do, but guys like that are who initially got me hooked. People like Randy Orton, my all-time favorite, which it's strange. I wasn't as big a fan of his when I was a child, but I later on, as I got into professional wrestling and started watching him, obviously, William Regal, my all-time favorite. Guys like him, Fit Finlay. I've become more so recently influenced by the European style of wrestling, not so much the American style anymore. Still love both, but I guess I sympathize more with that. I blend more with that, I feel.
I think with the Americans, I mean, American style is a bit more theatrical, I suppose. I've learned from guys like MVP is a big proponent for European style. It's just a little bit snugger. It's a little bit close contact. You can just do a little bit more subtleties, I suppose, in just digging in your elbow a little bit here and there and just torturing people more than actual just doing the big moves and that kind of thing. Was that kind of draw you to it?
Oh, absolutely. I very much rather prefer a nice hard-fought contest than guys just doing flips. I mean, I respect it. You can do it. That's great. But that's just not my style. It's not for me. I prefer a good, classic professional wrestling match where you got two guys that go in there and they're looking for a fight. There's going to be a winner, or they're going to kill each other trying to win. And to me, that's what I'm drawn to.
First of all, I mean, you mentioned three guys who were just perfect for that. Of course, Benoit, again, we're concentrating on the wrestler, not the person, etc. We've got to put that disclaimer there somewhere. Got Finlay, of course, who, yeah, it was Finlay was one of those guys who, when he debuted, because I wasn't aware of his WCW stuff, because When he started, I was 9. So I didn't watch it. I watched Worldwide. That was about as close as I got to WCW. So when he debuted, I was like, this is just an old guy. What's he going to do? And then he would just absolutely leather people and just batter them with an inch of their life. I was going, okay, cool. All right. I get that now. I'll just won't ever say anything bad about Finlay because you'll find out somehow and kill me. Like Dave Taylor was another. Didn't get Dave Taylor. He just looked like an old guy. And then I saw him wrestle live and I was like, oh, okay, I get why Dave Taylor's here. He's just nasty to work with.
Just two men who were going to go in there and they were going to fight each other to an inch of their life. There was going to be blood, there was going to be sweat, there was going to be broken bones, but they were there to do one thing, and that was to fight. You know, Finlay, my name's Finlay, I love to fight, and he proved that every single time he stepped in the ring. Because in the same situation as you, I was born in 1997, so I didn't watch a lot of WCW growing up. I didn't become a wrestling fan until I was about maybe 10 years old, I believe. So that was well past my time. But I go back and I watch those clips, and to this day, Finlay versus William, or Belfast Bruiser versus Lord Steven Regal is one of my all-time favorite matches. It wasn't flashy. They didn't do anything. They just went out there and they just beat the absolute bollocks off of each other, and it was amazing.
So how did you go from then watching that to going, you know what, I think I can give this a go myself? Did you have a sports background before you tried, or what was your kind of experience there?
I say this to a lot of the guys. I'm the most non-athletic athlete you're going to meet. I was not a big sports guy in high school. I'm not an avid sports fan. I like amateur wrestling. I did that the last 2 years of my schooling. Did all right. Didn't do the best. Didn't do the worst either. But it's actually funny. I became more attuned to that after I got out of high school and got into professional wrestling than I did when I was actually in amateur wrestling. But I met a lad at a gym. He was a trainer. He was actually my mom's personal trainer. And I met him when I was about 13 or 14. And he told me he used to be a professional wrestler. And that just was, you know, he never made it big or anything like that. He was just a local guy. But that completely blew me away. And I started talking to him, started hanging out with him. I've known him for years now. And he's actually the one that kind of initially broke me in. I started just setting the ring up, running music, doing announcing. Just whatever I could do to be around it, I would do. Transition into refereeing. I did that for about a year and a half. And then eventually transitioned to the in-ring work. I made my professional debut. I want to say it was what was the day? It was first week of May 2017. I don't remember the exact day, to be honest with you. Concussions and all that. But 2017 is when I made my professional wrestling debut.
I noticed this with a lot of people there in wrestling, that when you said it blew your mind that when you met someone who was a wrestler, when we were younger, I suppose, unless you're in like a big town that has an actual like proper wrestling scene, you don't think you're going to ever be a wrestler. You either find something to do outside of that, or you take up a martial art, or in your case, you took up amateur wrestling, thinking that'll also be the closest I'll get to it, to actually being a pro wrestler. And because a lot of the guys I speak to do like karate or taekwondo or judo, just because you get that physicality, but you don't think you can actually be a wrestler. And then you see guys, well, now in Scotland especially, you've got Doudrop, you've got Nicky Ash, you've got guys in NXT UK, you've got Drew. How could I leave him that late in my list there? You've got Drew, and it's just a case of now you're looking at these guys, and I'm sure there's guys from it's Tennessee. There's thousands, there's hundreds of wrestlers of Tennessee that have made the big time. Your Jarretts and your Lawlers and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, you don't think it's going to be possible. As far as the independent scene, then when you got in say born 97, didn't become a wrestling fan to about 2005, 2007 time. What did you end up getting into the indie scene at all? Did your parents take you to any independent shows?
Not at all. My parents are very much opposed to what I do. It's just, they're not fans of it. And that, you know, that's okay. We've made our peace with that. We still love each other, but they're not fans of what I do. You know, they don't come with that. That's okay. If I don't want them to come, if they don't want to be there, because I'm of the opinion, I do not want someone to come watch me if they do not want to be there. Because that, to me, that's the worst thing ever, dragging someone to something that they do not want to be at just because they have to see you. I'll show them clips. They want to see it. If they ask me when it is, I'll tell them, but they don't come and that's okay. I knew nothing about independent wrestling. Nothing. Honestly, I didn't get much independent knowledge until after I kind of started associating and the business itself. I was very much, you know, I watched WWE as a child. I watched TNA, you know, back when it was Total Nonstop Action, when they were still running out of Orlando, when guys like AJ Styles, Samoa Joe, Kurt Angle had just got there. I watched that a lot as a kid. It wasn't until I started setting up the ring and independent shows and things like that that I actually learned that, hey, there is a scene out there that you could just go to and you can talk to people and meet people and actually meet the people that do what you want to do. And to me, that was amazing.
So as far as your first day of training, then you say you did a bit of amateur wrestling. So you maybe know a little bit here and there if something goes awry. But how did you find, I don't know if you're wrestling on mats or if it was a ring, or what was your first couple sessions like?
Well, it was a ring, and it was absolutely brutal. This guy leathered me left and right. I was brought up with a very old school mentality, because where I do live in Tennessee, a lot of the lads around here, especially the veterans who've been doing this for a while, still subscribe very much to the old school way of thinking. They, you know, that you got to be tough to do this. And that's, you know, and some people, I think it has a bad stigma at times, because there's people that don't do it correctly. These guys let me know what I was in for first day. They looked at me, they said, look, this is going to hurt. You're going to leave here, you're going to be sore, but we want to make sure that you want to actually do this. And I said, I want to do it. And they beat the granny out of me. The first thing I ever did was one of my trainers, he looked at me and said, I want you to go stand in the corner. And I said, okay. He said, now I'm going to chop you. Keep your hands on the top turnbuckle. I'm going to chop you, because if you can't take this, you don't need to be here. And I said, okay. And he chopped me, and I thought he put his hand through my chest. It hurt a lot. But after that, you know, I went through it, started traditional with your traditional bumps. The first bump I ever took, I thought I was going to die. I thought my ribs were broken, because we were in a ring, but it was a very, very stiff, very little padding. It didn't move. It was a challenge, but after a while, you know, you get in the habit of doing it, and you get to going back, and then you fall in love with it. I've always said, you know, as professional wrestlers, we're not all right in the head. You know, we get slammed on wood and metal with about that much padding. We're not all right, but I fell in love with it immediately, and I kept going back, and eventually I was able to, you know, get in there with the guys, and then I had their respect. And to this day, I look back on that with the fondest of memories. Even though it was challenging, even though it was brutal, it was one of the best times in my life that I'll always cherish.
I like the sound of that, though. I mean, of course, there's the old school way of if you're going to get hurt and they're going to batter you. But I like the way you put it is they didn't take liberties. They literally came up to you and said, this is what we're going to do. It's going to hurt. And so you didn't go in with it going, all right, I'm just going to get to the corner. What's going to happen next? And then it just absolutely just batter you for it. No. I like at least they've kind of molded that old school mentality of it's going to hurt with, you know, we're going to tell you why I'm doing it this way, why we're doing it this way, why it's why I'm throwing you in this particular direction, why we're always working at, well, that's why I'm going to pull you at a certain side. It's a good way of, it's a good way to mesh, I suppose. And, you know, I mean, I've never done it. I've never done training. I have no interest in it at all because, you know, I get hurt very easily. So I just like, nah, I'll just do this instead. I'll do podcast. I'll do writing. I'll do anything I can to be in the business, but not in the business at the same time, because, you know, I don't want to be punched. That's just the easiest
thing. No, I have respect for that, because you know what you want to do and you go after it, and that's great. Because there were guys that showed up to training that really thought, like, I'm going to do this, and they had in their minds, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to leave here, I'm going to go to the WWE. They had the big dream in that, and that's great. But after the first day of training, I would never see him again. And it was unfortunate, because a lot of them, they were great lads. They were nice people, and, you know, we got along great, but they would do 1-2 sessions, they wouldn't come back. And it was depressing to watch, just because you want everyone to love it and do it. But at the end of the day, there are times that some people, they, you know, for example, one of the lads, he went through one session with us. He said, you know, I don't think wrestling, the actual wrestling of it, is for me. However, I do think I could be a really good ring announcer. I do think I could be a really good referee. And he fell in that, and he's booked all the time. You know, he refs constantly. So I'm always a fan of, not just because you're not a professional wrestler does not mean you're not in the wrestling business, does not mean that you are any on a less peg than the rest of us. I hate that personal mentality, because there have been guys that I've met, not trying to call anyone out or, you know, or talk down on someone, not trying to do that at all. But there have been people I've met that just because the person they interacted with wasn't a wrestler, they were beneath them. And I'm like, that's not, you know, I'm a lord, you know, I'm, I'm a lord, you know, I am nobility, but at the same time, I still believe in showing respect for people as best as you possibly can, especially when you have the guts to come in here and actually try this and say, you know what, it didn't work out for me, but I think this will. And then you find that you're one of the best referees that they're in the scene. You're one of the best ring announcers. There are places and there are positions, and it does not mean that you are in less of a totem pole just because you're not a professional wrestler. Because, like I said, met a lot of guys that have that mentality, and I cannot stand it. It drives me up a wall.
It's kind of guys that come in with they already got the wrestling character and their gear and their wrestling music and all that kind of stuff sorted already. So that's fine. I just need to do the bumpy bit. I'm all good. I've got the rest of it sorted. Down pat. But no, speaking of
the
that respect,
guys, thing, they spend a lot of money on gear. They spend a lot of money on fancy music, you know, and they come in, they think, oh, well, I'm going to be a star. You know, I've got the superstar mentality. And they get in there and they realize, oh, I'm starting from the bottom. Yeah, you are. Welcome to the locker room, lad. It's not as easy as you think it is.
No, you speak about that respect thing. I did a couple of driving gigs for a company. I pick up guys from the airport, pick up like a Joey Legend or something from the airport, and I would take them to the show. And it's fine. It's all good, cool like that. But one time we had a show come up, and he wrestled a Scotland called Liam Thompson. He was a champion for this particular promotion. He came in, he kind of, not burst in, but he just like came into this room where all of us crew, quote unquote, were sitting. He just came in, shook everyone's hand, went, I'm Liam. And I'm sitting there going, I know. you're the champion. Of course I know who you are. But no, he shook everyone in that room's hand, introduced himself, and then left, and that was him. And I was like, you did not need to do that. No one needs to do that. And there he is. As that's how you represent, I suppose, your business, your promotion, and of course yourself as a person. So it's a weird thing, this respect thing. I'm not used to it, but it's so amazing when it's shown that you think, ah, you're one of the good ones then. That's a fact. So when did you discover your nobility, your roots for Scottish strong style?
Well, it's funny you should mention that. As I say, you know, I'm really influenced with with European wrestling, as I stated previously. But around the era that I wrestled in, I noticed a lot of guys they weren't doing the European style. You know, they were doing the, you know, nice Southern, you know, Memphis style wrestling, which is great. You know, that's great for the era that we're in. However, I wanted to bring something a little bit different. I was like, oh, okay, you know, some of these guys they're not really familiar with European style wrestling. They're not familiar with the stuff that I enjoy watching and the roots that I try to bring here. So I'm going to show them, and I did, and it just clicked. And I was like, okay, what can I do? Because I didn't just want to be like, oh, I'm just a European wrestler. I wanted to kind of, you know, bring it to, you know, regionalize it, bring it to a certain, you know, a really strong brand. I was like, okay. So you got Shinsuke Nakamura. He's strong. He's the king of strong style. I was like, I could be the king of. I could be the king of Scottish strong style. And I said that in my head just kind of as a joke. And I was like, oh, wait a minute. That clicks. I like that. I'm going to put it on a t-shirt. And I did.
Of course, they are available at Pro Wrestling Tees. We'll get more plugs in towards the end, I'm sure. But I was having a look at them and I was going, damn, they're pretty cool t-shirts. I was like, if I think it may have a European outlet, I'm going to have to double check that a little bit more, because, you know, that'll just suit this brand quite a bit more, Scottish Wrestling Network.
We're in one right now.
Oh, that is very nice. That is so cool. So that's for the video viewers. You go check out the video. If you're listening on audio, you can get to check that out. But so as far as like the Scottish scene then, or Scottish roots that you've got going on there, was there anyone in particular, have you been able to check out anything from here that may have implemented? I suppose the most famous thing coming out of Scotland now would be in ICW, so it's a bit more less European style, more death matchy. But is there anything that you've been able to check out at this side of the pond?
Well, it's when I got started wrestling, I started watching independent European wrestling, because I didn't know anything about American indie wrestling, much less European indie wrestling. I didn't know anything about it. So I started kind of looking it up. I discovered like a Progress Wrestling first, and then I started watching, you know, the English wrestling. And then I learned about ICW in Scotland and a couple other smaller companies. Joe Hendry, that was one of the first guys I saw, and I watched him and I thought, that lad is nothing but charisma. Like, you can't replicate that. You can't duplicate it. You can't fake that. That was the Johemian Rhapsody. I can't remember who he was wrestling. It was an ICW event, I believe. and just the work that man put into his character, and just everything he did would just blew me away. Because I'm very much, a wrestler guy, but I love entertaining gimmicks as well. Like, I love guys who really have big personalities and put it out there, and they do it in an entertaining way. I thought that was just amazing. Wolfgang, that's another one I saw before. The NXT UK brand really got set up properly. I thought, Jesus, that's one line I don't want to cross, because I just would watch him just hit people. So it's honestly, it's to me, it's kind of a throwback of watching Fenley when he would just get in there and just batter people. So it was really amazing to watch him. Obviously McIntyre, I don't think you can mention Scottish wrestling without bringing up Drew McIntyre, just because I thought it was just so amazing to see, when he was in WWE the first time and he had his run there, and then he left, and then he just went to the Indies and just bulked up, became a massive superstar, and showed how good he actually was, and then went back, and then he's on top of the world. So that was amazing too. ICW, I haven't watched as much of it as I probably should have, to be honest with you. I've kind of fallen out of touch with some things recently. The last time I watched a full ICW event is when Trent Seven was on the card.
And a while ago,
it's been a while since I watched a full event. I cannot remember who he's wrestling. Again, I'm sorry, concussions.
That's all right. I mean, if it was Trent, it's probably someone like maybe a Joe Coffey or probably a Wolfgang. But yeah, I think
it was Joe, actually, now that you mentioned. I think it was Coffey. And I watched them. I don't remember quite who, but they had just this barn burner of a match, because I love Trent Seven. Like, Mustache Mountain, British Strong Style, I love those guys. And I watched the match. I thought, this is amazing. I want to go wrestle there at some point, because the big goal of mine, like, obviously, everyone has a dream. Oh, I want to go wrestle with the WWE. I want to go to AEW. They want to go to the big companies. And that's obviously a goal. But something I try to do, I try to plan out, where can I get first? Before I go here, what can I do? A big goal of mine is the United Kingdom. I want to wrestle in England. I want to wrestle in Scotland. I want to wrestle in Ireland. I want to be a world travel wrestler. I don't just want to be, a guy wrestles, the same 40 miles. Not there's anything wrong with that. There's not. But I want something a little bit more. I want to actually be able to say, I've traveled the world. I've wrestled here. I've wrestled here. I wrestled this country. I've done this, this, and this. So even if you don't make it to the big, to the big Fed, you still can say, I've traveled the world. I've done things that no one else in their regular life would get to do. And I'm really hoping I get to say that.
Yeah, so I mean, yeah. If all ended tomorrow, you can turn around and go, well, I went over to Germany and I got paid to wrestle in Germany in WXW or something like that, or absolutely. I was in ICW or was in Discovery or something like that. But we spoke about Joe Hendry. That must have just been when he was signed for Ring of Honor. There must have been a thought in the back of your head going, oh, this could be possible then. It's getting a bit closer, because now he's across my side. He's now in the US.
Yeah.
It's just a shame then a pandemic happened and then that's ruined it.
Entirely. Well, pandemic ruined a lot of things, because it is. I thought it was funny, because I still have my 2020 book. Because I'm, even though I'm 24 years old, I'm still an old man at heart. I actually have a book. I write my dates down. Easier for me to remember. For the year of 2020, I had over 100 dates booked. So I was super excited. It was actually a possibility that I was going to be coming to the United Kingdom and possibly Australia as well. There have been a couple little talks here and there about that, and it was just kind of out there as a possibility. Then COVID happens, and my 100 dates turned into like 15 before the year was out. So it was really disappointing. But what can you do?
But as long as you make it past and you're still safe and alive, mainly, then yeah, the rest of it's just you have to take it as it is.
Standing or sitting at the moment, anyway.
Exactly. That's it. I mean, for the pandemic, much like this, the storm that's just happened, I really noticed. I got sent home in March last year, and I've probably not left this room since. I've just churned out podcasts. That's what I've done instead. So, that's the unfortunate atrocity I've brought onto the world, is me speaking for hours on end. But again, as long as you make it past 100 dates to 15, at least you got that 15, I suppose, the silver lining.
Better than nothing.
Exactly. So rewinding back a little bit to your debut. So you've started this training. You're paying your dues, as they say, and then you've got your first match. How much notice did you get? Were you just kind of thrown in. What was your kind of experience for your first match?
Oh, it was absolutely horrible. It was one of the worst matches I've ever had in my life. There is no video footage of it that I can find. If I'm able to find it, I will destroy it because it's just god awful. I was in a National Guard armory in Bristol, Tennessee, in front of 20 people in the middle of summer, not knowing what I'm doing. I wasn't out there with an experienced veteran. I was out there with another guy that I had kind of come up with, and we went out there and we absolutely just ruined. I'm trying to put this in a PG way.
Dunk the place up. Would that be accurate?
Fair enough. Yeah, we went out there. We dunked the joint out. We killed the crowd dead. It was horrible. And I got in the back, and my trainer looked at me and said, "Well, that was trash." And I said, "Yeah, it was." I was like, "Oh, that was so good." And they're like, "Yeah, no, it wasn't. It was horrible." Because when you first come back and you got that adrenaline rush, I just had my first professional wrestling match. This is amazing. It was great. No, it wasn't. But you take your licks, you learn how to do this correctly, because you can train all day long, but I'm of the opinion the best way you learn is by getting out there and actually doing it, wrestling people who are better than you and who will ultimately make you a better professional wrestler. I've been fortunate. I've actually got to work with some people that have made me better, and I'm still, ways to go, but I feel where I am now versus where I was, 4.5 years ago is night and day. So it's amazing just to see kind of where I've come from versus where I'm at now. But yeah, first match, completely horrible. I have no positive notes about it whatsoever.
You see that? I mean, I've seen quite a few debuts in my time because I'm old and I've watched wrestling for 2012 is when I started watching indie wrestling anyway in Scotland. I started watching wrestling in 1999. So I started it before you'd even proper got into the world properly at that point. But no, I've seen people make their debut and the moves are fine. That's okay. Nobody's hurt at the end of it. Great. But there's no connection. And that's the bit that always gets missed, I feel. And if you get that in your first night, then geez, you're going to be a superstar in a matter of months. How did you find that crowd connection? Was that the bit that you weren't so sure about when you started, or what was the kind of, I don't know how you were with a crowd in general? Were you quite outspoken? Were you introvert? What was your kind of experience working with an audience?
So I come from a theater background. I did theater in high school and things like that, and a little bit in my first semester of college. So I'm not afraid to go out in front of people. That's never been a fear of mine. My fear was I'm going to go out here and I'm not going to do my job correctly. The second I stepped through the curtain and the second I opened my mouth, the people hated me. They wanted to see me get killed. They wanted to see me run out of town. They absolutely hated me. And I thrive on that because I very much enjoy making people who are less intelligent than me angry. It's one of my favorite pastimes. I got the microphone because how I actually got my spot at a lot of promotions is I could talk. I could talk to people, whereas a lot of people, they would get, kind of quiet. They wouldn't know what to say, or they would just be saying words, but they wouldn't actually have any emotion behind it. And I would out there and actually conveyed a convincing, believing everything I was saying, because I did. And the people just were on me from the start. So the connection I never thought was the problem. At least not from the beginning. There's been times where it hasn't clicked with people, where I've tried to go out there and be a nice guy and, try to be more polite. And some people, they just don't get with it. And if you don't get with it, well, I tried. I'm just going to be me now.
That's the thing. Yeah. I mean, it's always, I find it's always easier to be the bad guy because, people don't take long to hate. To hate others, that's just a very easy thing to do. It's trying to get them to warm up to like you, which is the hard thing, especially if you don't particularly either want them to like you or have no volition to try. Well, not even try, I suppose, but if they don't like you, you're like, ah, okay, I've tried then, so next I'll just go back to what I know and how I can get a reaction that way.
This is just me, and other people don't feel this way, and that's fine. I could care less what any of the wrestling fans think about me. If you like me, great. If you don't, I could care less, because at the end of the day, I'm going to go out there. I'm going to wrestle my match. I'm going to win. I'm going to get paid. I'm going to go home. Nothing that anyone says or does is going to stop that from happening. So if the fans want to get behind me and support me, I'm all for it. If you don't, well, that's your prerogative. Either way, I'm going to do what I do. That's win professional wrestling matches.
Well, as long as you react, that's the whole John Cena thing. As long as you make a noise and react one way or another, that's your job's done. In that respect, anyway. As far as riling up the crowd, fans, then I don't know what the security is like. Just because we're coming off a week where a fan jumped and attacked Seth Rollins in the middle of a live Raw show.
I saw that.
Is any fan? Have you ever riled someone up enough that they've?
A few times. So a lot of these shows, I'm going to use Tennessee for an example. Tennessee, these fans are very much old school wrestling fans. They believe it. They are one. They come to a show, they believe it, and I love that. I absolutely love that. I thrive on that because it's really easy to make them mad. As I stated previously, enjoy making people less intelligent than me angry. For example, I'll give you an example of one night that this happened. This happened twice in the same town. So there is a town called Rocky Top, Tennessee. It's about 45 minutes outside of Knoxville, Tennessee, which is one of the bigger cities, and Eastern Tennessee, which is where I live. It is one of the worst places on God's green earth. If you've never been, start doing math. You'll get there eventually. I'm at another show in Knoxville, just with some mates of mine. And a friend who was at that show says, "Hey, I'm also going to this event tonight." And they called me. They said they need another wrestler. Do you want to go? Sure. I don't put my stuff on at the event that I'm already at because I get told we're going to be the main event because it's me, obviously. So no problem. So we get in a car and we're driving. And as I get there, I see my opponent walking to the curtain and he says, "My music's playing." So I'm literally like hopping to the curtain, tying my boots to go out. So I go out, we do the match. And as I'm leaving, some bearded redneck says something to me. And I don't even know what I said. Doesn't matter. And he says something to me that's not very PG. And I turn and I see him stand up and he pulls out a knife. And I'm like, okay. And I put my fist up. I'm like, you want to have a go? Bring it, mate. Then his buddy stands up and he unholsters his gun. Now I'm thinking I might die tonight, but whatever. I'm not backing down. Then the security, which just involved two older gentlemen and security t-shirts, not real security. Security is virtually non-existent at a lot of these shows. It's not a thing. There's not a rail. So we very much have to keep our eyes open, especially if the fans are more riled up than normal. But they were able to kind of keep the guys away from me so we could get in the back. And then we got in the car and went back to Knoxville and we actually passed the cops on the way to the building. So yeah, I started a riot in Rocky Top. 2 months after that happened, once again, I'm at a show in Morristown, Tennessee, which is about an hour from Rocky Top. Same little area there, right? So am I going too fast?
Oh, no, I'm with you. I'm just, you hear stereotypes of America. This isn't helping it, but it kind of...
No, it's not. It's absolutely terrible. And that's why I'm telling you this, so everyone can know what lovely fans we have in East Tennessee. So I'm at a show in Morristown. And a friend of mine is at the show also, same thing. "Hey, this event is needing people. Do you want to go try to get shot again?" Sure, I'm all for it. Let's see if we can make it happen twice. So the first event we're at, we're in this big like 8-man elimination, completely cluster match. And I get eliminated. Well, the guy that I'm riding with is in the ring and he gets eliminated immediately after me. And he is talking to the people taking his time. And my thought is, we have to get on the road. So I grab him, I pull him out of the ring, and I punch him to let him know, "Hey, we got to go." And we start fighting. One of the security guards, like, underhooks my arms behind me to where I can't move my upper body. So I'm thinking, if he throws a live round, he's going to hit me in the face. He's going to knock me out. So I look at the guy, and I say, "Let go of me." And he goes, "You're not going anywhere." And he latches onto me. So I get free, and I scream, "Get the off me," and I elbow him in the face, and he let go of me then. So then we get in the car and we go to this other place, and we get there and the promoter comes up to us and says, "Hey, the opponent from the main event who's wrestling our champion has canceled. So your match is now going to determine who wrestles the champion in the main event." So, and our match is directly before that. So we do our match, and then the guy that I rode with is wrestling the champion. Well, the promoter comes up to me and says, hey, I want you to go out there and I want you to jump both of them. Sure thing. So I go out to the ring. I get on them and I blast them both with the title and I hold it up, letting them know, hey, you might think you're top dog, but you're not. One of his security guards gets in the ring and looks at me and says, you need to go, and pushes me. And I look at him and say, you don't touch me. Do you want me to hit you? And he says, yeah, hit me. Well, don't tell me to hit you if you don't want me to hit you. I go to hit him. He hooks the title like under his arm and tries to hook a very poorly executed chokehold on me. And I wind up double-legging him and taking him down because I've got that amateur wrestling background. I pop my head out, and at this point, I have completely lost my mind because this is the second time in one night this has happened. I pop out, and I start raining down on him because, again, this is, you know, old-school mentality. I was always taught, you know, if a fan or someone gets in there and they're trying to cause you harm, you better keep hitting them because if you stop hitting them, they're going to start hitting you. So you got to protect – you have to protect yourself. So I'm on this guy and I'm wailing on him and I get him away from me. And then like six more security guards get in the ring and I get out because I'm not fighting seven people. And I step out through the curtain and I lose my mind. You know, I'm cussing, profanity going all over the place. And the guy came up to me later on the night and apologized and said, I'm sorry, I lost my cool. And I looked at him and said, don't lose your cool again around me. And then I just walked away and I haven't been back to that town since. I said, no, not going back. First time almost got shot and stabbed. Second time one of the security guards tried to fight me. I'm not going back anymore.
Oh yeah. So as we see Rocky Top pop up on the old MSN. How old am I? On the old Twitter or messenger, but no, I'll close that one. Let's just mute it. I'm not seeing that again.
Terrible.
That is.
They have a hotel. I saw this and it blew my mind. A Scottish Inn is what it's called. And I look at it, I'm like, that's not from Scotland.
I would bet that all it does is just, they serve haggis maybe and have some shortbread, Walker's shortbread.
Oh no, they don't even have that. Because I drove past it because I was curious. I saw the sign. I'm like, I've got to check this out. It looks like a place that you would find a meth lab. No disrespect to anyone who stays there. However, it's not the nicest of hotels. And I've stayed in some rundown hotels before in my past. So I know what it's like and it's fine, but I'm like, this is not Scottish. Like I was offended. I'm like, this is offensive. Like I want to take your sign down and because you clearly have no idea what you're talking about.
It's like they may have came over for one trip and ended up in like some sort of East End in Glasgow, a really terrible place, and went, oh, this must be what Scotland is. I've just found the worst area, rundown area in the world. I went, oh, this must be what it is.
Guarantee they just watched Braveheart. Never
train spotting. Probably train spotting. You know, oh, that's fine. That's what they do. They just get shoot up on heroin and that's what Scottish people do. Oh God, Braveheart! What a film that makes you both happy and angry at the same time to be Scottish. Because you watch it and you're like, "Yeah, freedom!" And you watch it going, "What is that accent? Why is there a van in the background? This isn't right. This is wrong in all sorts of ways." But oh God, I still want to watch it again now. Now we've mentioned Braveheart, you know, Scottish.
Oh, it's amazing! It's amazing.
It gets even better with age, as in you can see, if you do the basic history, you know it's all wrong, but you're still going, freedom, at the end of it, going, yes!
Well, the funny thing about all that is I actually did a report, like I watched Braveheart as a kid because it was one of my dad's favorite movies. I was like, oh, this is amazing, and then I did a report on William Wallace in high school, and as I was doing the report, I'm like, this movie is entirely wrong. This is not what I thought this was going to be. It was quite disappointing.
Oh yeah, they took creative license and they stretched it as far as they could. Yep, that's it. We're going to bring people that weren't even alive at the time, or it's going to marry a 20-year-old, but in reality they were about 12 at the time.
That doesn't sell. You can't put that in the movie.
No, I don't think you can. I don't think families would particularly want to watch that. It'd be a bit weird. So I was looking through like the places that you wrestled more recently. I usually go to Cage Match. That's my bible for finding matches. Unfortunately, I don't have a profile, so I've done my best here. So I've got places like Pro Wrestling Union, World Fighting Showcase, Mid-Atlantic Wrestling, AIWF, So as far as matches and wrestling, is there any particular highlights that you've had that haven't involved you almost dying that you want to?
Oh, you know, loads. You know, for example, World Fighting Showcase. That was, you know, that's one of that's one of my main places that I work at, and it's really where I've got to interact with people that have been doing this for a while and actually kind of hold me and try to make me better. For example, there's the gentleman who owns it. Are you familiar with like 2002 OVW?
The guys who came through it.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Do you remember the Disciples of Sin?
Oh, they're in TNA. Yeah, I remember the Disciples of Sin.
Damien, Brian Logan, is actually the guy who owns that. So that I met him and we connected and he hired me and I started working there. This coming April will have been 3 years ago, which they're on a little bit of a hiatus right now due to, you know, other problems. But that's one of the places that I worked primarily. And I got to interact. I got to go to WrestleCade thanks to them. They booked an event. They booked a match where I was on the WrestleCade Showcase Champion Show, which is the big event in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, that just happened this past weekend. So I got to experience that for the first time, which was absolutely amazing. You know, being in the locker room with guys like, you know, Killer Cross before he got signed, Tracy Smothers, you know, may he rest in peace, before he passed away, he was in the locker room chatting up with all the lads. You know, got Willie Mack, Brian Cage, just being in a locker room with them and just kind of being like acknowledged as like an equal, even though, you know, talent wise I'm not, but being acknowledged as like an equal to them was just amazing. Pro Wrestling Union in South Carolina is one of my favorite places to go. I love there's a great pool of young talent there. And you've got guys, there's one guy who's worked there the past couple of times I've been there. You may know him, you might not, I'm not entirely certain, but he's incredibly talented. The Infinite Man, T.I.M. Tim. One of the best human beings. If you haven't seen him before, I encourage you to look him up. One of the best human beings ever. One of the best professional wrestlers to me that there is going right now. And just to be in the locker room with guys like that and learn from guys like him. Let me think who else. Because there's, like I said, there's been many, many people that I've got to interact with in places like that that have just been, you know, for example, Bobby Eaton before he passed away. I didn't get to interact with him at World Fighting Showcase, but I did get to interact with him at Build Zone D 6 months after I started in a town, Rockwood, Tennessee, for a company called MSWA. I did a couple shows with them when I first got started, and Build Zone D was booked on that show, and so was Bobby Eaton. And the Midnight Express is my all-time favorite tag team. So that was, you know, a wonderland for me because I got to meet, you know, a guy that I absolutely idolize and I still think, you know, was one of the best that there will ever be. Again, may he rest in peace also. It's been a tough year, man. We're losing just idols left and right. It's depressing. But, you know, may he rest in peace. But I met Bill Zone D and he looked at me, he heard me talk and immediately I thought, oh God. Because I was like, he's gonna punch me. That's what I thought. He's gonna punch me in the face. But he was very cool to me, very respectful to me. Cool to see him go out there and do. Because I watch old Memphis wrestling a lot to kind of learn. Because to me, like when you were talking about connecting with the crowd, I think Memphis was one of the best places that ever happened because they didn't have to go out there and, you know, you didn't see all kinds of flips and things like that. You saw just emotion out of the people, and I thought that was amazing. So to talk with Bill and watch him do his thing was absolutely amazing. AIWF Mid-Atlantic is based out of Mount Airy, North Carolina, one of the very few places where the fans actually like me. It is different. I'm actually, one second here. Sorry, my shoulders. I'm actually one half of their tag team champions right now. We'll showcase them. We'll put their belts over. I'm currently going in on almost 900 days as the World Fighting Champion.
That is a nice belt. I love a belt that has a different colored strap. It does it for me. Nice.
Going on collectively 900 days as World Fighting Showcase Television Champion. Defended that against some great people. But yeah, just those three places are some of my favorite places that I've ever got to be fortunate enough to go work for. I'm hoping, which right now I'm dealing with a little bit of a shoulder injury. So I'm hoping that it's not too serious, because if it is, I might have to be out for a while, and that'll, you know, that'll be missing some great events and missing some paydays, so that's unfortunate. But those three places are three of my favorite places that I go. The promoters and the people that own those events, they know that should they need Lord Murphy Costigan, I will show up and be there, and I will bring Scottish Strong Style to those events.
WrestleCade, I've seen it on the Twitter, because I follow Ella J, who does the Wrestling Gal podcast. She does quite a lot of stuff, independence now, and WrestleCade was one that popped up. I think she was doing something for either WrestleZone.com or Fightful, possibly something like that. I'm not entirely sure. But yeah, so I was seeing a lot of buzz about WrestleCade. When you're speaking about Bobby Eaton, of course, he teamed with William Regal as well in WCW. So along with getting to pick his brain, were you trying to nab some Regal stories in there as well, just to see what you could try and grab a puzzle piece somewhere for your own
journey? Yeah, absolutely. I was worried. I didn't want to, because I know, you know, Bobby was one of the nicest human beings ever, but I didn't want to just sit there and just chew his ear off the whole night, like, because I know that he probably got that a lot, and I didn't want to be that guy that just, you know, will not leave him alone. So I didn't get as much out of him as I would have loved, because I could have sat and talked to Bobby for days on end and never got bored of it. But I got to talk to him a little bit, and, you know, just kind of asked him, you know, if he watched the match, and he said that he didn't. But I got to talk to him about, you know, tag team wrestling a little bit here and there, and got to speak with him, and just, you know, just to see how he would treat people. You know, a guy that is as good as he is, that accomplished all the things that he accomplished, and just to see him interact with other people, you would have never thought that he had been, because he never acted like he was the best thing in the world. You know, he treated himself very humbly, was very respectful, very nice to all of the lads and lasses in the locker room. And Bobby Eaton, because I didn't get to have as much experience around Bobby as I would have liked. I only interact with him maybe two or three times on events that we were on together. But a guy who has started managing me lately, you probably won't know who he is. His name is Bo James. He was in Memphis. He's worked the Tennessee area. He's done independence. A lot of people are like, "Oh God, I said Bo James." Yeah, I did. he knew Bobby, and they lived together for a while. And he got to make towns with guys like Bobby, Ricky, you know, the Rock and Roll Express, Dr. Tom Pritchard, you know, Bill Dundee, Jerry the King Lawler. He got to be around all those guys. So I got to know Bobby a lot through him, more so than I did through Bobby himself, if that makes sense. I rambled a little bit there. I apologize. But I got to just hear about how all the great things that Bobby had done, and how much he had helped, you know, he had helped people get better and just kind of learn how to do this correctly. And it was just, it's just amazing to hear all the positive things that he contributed, not just to the wrestling side of this, but also to the gentlemen and the lasses in the locker room, the people that he was around, that he was able to influence. And he just made any locker room that he was in better just by being there.
I was thinking about other people that I've had the just been luck to meet in. Like, you kind of don't know if they're going to be like nice to you, I suppose, or if they're just going to dismiss you. But Roddy Piper would be the name that I first came to mind. Met him twice over the years. He was at my first independent wrestling show that I went to, and I went in nervous. You know, it's Roddy Piper. He main evented WrestleMania. He's wrestled Hulk Hogan. He's wrestled the biggest names in the world, and you think you could just sign your stuff and then leave and cool. But no, first time, chatted with me for ages. Second time I met him, I told him because of him I got into Scottish wrestling, because that was the reason why I went to the show. And he seemed really emotional about it. And I was wearing a Fratz t-shirt. I don't know if you've seen the old Hot Rod Fratz t-shirt. It's got the name listed, yeah, of all the names on the back of people who passed away. And he got emotional about that. And I was like, "You're Roddy Piper. How are you getting emotional about me, a fat Scottish guy that's come just to say hello to you? And you're looking at my t-shirt and you're..." My only disappointment for the whole thing was, at the time, I did a very, very low-viewed YouTube show called OSW TV, which was unfortunate because OSW Review was around about the same time, so that kind of screwed that. But it was called OSW TV, and I had this belt made. In the loosest possible terms, I put OSW on an old WWF plastic championship, and I took it with me. And that's the picture I have with Roddy. And every time I look at it and go, why did you take that belt? That was the worst thing you could have done ever. But he liked it. So, you know, but yeah, it's more regret seeing that. But Roddy Piper, amazing. And plus, we still keep him as Scottish. I don't care what anyone else says. He's Canadian. No, he wore a kilt, played bagpipes. He's ours. We're keeping him forever.
honorary Scotsman. I never got to meet Roddy, unfortunately. He passed away before I ever got the chance to do that. But he is one of the people that I absolutely love going back and watching old tapes. So just watching old Piper's pit segments, because it's actually funny. So quick detour back to when I first started. The company that I first started for, obviously they heard the accent, they saw what I was doing, and they instantly thought, hey, Roddy Piper. And they wanted to give me like a Roddy Piper-esque talk segment. So it was Murphy's Law was my talk segment. And so I would watch just hours of Piper's Pit segments, trying to kind of, you know, see how he would do things, not to copy him, but just to see like how he would do the segments, how he would conduct himself, how he would get through everything. Still one of my all time favorite segments is when Frankie Williams, he was a WWF enhancement talent. And he's doing the interview with him, and he's just taking it right out of him. He just looks at him and goes, well, you're just a lousy wrestler, aren't you? You're just terrible. just tells him that he's horrible. And Frankie bucks up to him, and Piper just hits him. And then Frankie comes back and he hits him again and gives him like one of the worst as far as like how much it would hurt. Knee lifts right to the face, pushes him off set, and then he looks at the camera and says the patented line, as soon as they think they got the answers, I change the questions. And I saw that, and it blew me away just how captivating and how he would draw you in, and you didn't know what was going to happen, especially when he was in the ring, because he got those crazy eyes. Like, you looked in his eyes and you thought, oh God, either someone's about to die or someone's about to be seriously maimed.
Absolutely, and that's what it was back in the day. I suppose Tennessee, Memphis would be the same. But if you went in as this kind of 2021 critical brain thinking, you could probably watch a Memphis match and just go, "That was terrible." There was no actual moves. Nothing happened. But when you hear the crowd, the crowd are all in, and they're all in the motion. And when we're talking about like emotion and that, you said you're booed everywhere, you're causing riots, you're almost getting stabbed. What's it like going to, I think it was AIWF, what's it like going into there and people are cheering you instead? What's that like, I suppose, after all that time being booed?
It is the strangest feeling ever. Like, I've gotten used to it now because I've been there for a couple of years, but when I first got there, because me and my tag team partner, the other half of the Distinguished Noble Aristocrats, his name's Jordan Lawrence, we had always just been, you know, we had been booed everywhere we'd went, and that's mostly due to, you know, me, but because he would just get booed by association. Like, oh, you hang out with that guy, we don't like you either. We showed up at the AIWF and the fans just took to us, and it was very strange, because I'm like, you know, this is, you know, are you familiar with the Andy Griffith Show?
I'm familiar with it, yeah.
Mount Airy is Mayberry. It's the town it's based off of. They have an Andy Griffith Museum. So me, a Scottish lad, going to Mayberry to be a professional wrestler, coming out wearing a kilt, and the fans love me. It's just, it's so strange, but the people, they embraced us, you know, because we've hit some hard times going through there. You know, it's been a rocky road to the tag titles, let me tell you. But they embraced us. They took us in as one of their, you know, as one of their own. And, you know, it's a much different experience than I'm used to, but I absolutely love it.
Do you find that you need to change much with your character? Or is it pretty much just like the same character, but love
you? I'm not a character, mate. I'm just me. You know, I go out there and I'm me. Whether you like me or you hate me, you're going to get me. Mm-hmm. The fans seem to like me, so far so good. We'll see how long it stays that way. I have the effect on people that eventually you do get sick and tired of me, but we'll see. Gotten sick.
What I mean by that, you're not doing the come on guys hand claps and all that kind of stuff. You're just still you in that respect.
I go out if a fan, you know, sticks his hand out, You know, I'll do that, but I don't go around looking for it. You know, I go out there. When I step out for the curtain, I've got one goal on my mind. I'm going to go in the ring with this guy and or this girl, whoever. I'm going to have this match. I'm going to win this match. Depending on who it is will depend on the severity of pain that they're in throughout the course of the evening. So, for example, if it's someone who has messed me over, who has insulted me, insulted my friends, what have you, he's going to have a rough time. Versus if it's someone that I've never met before, you know, it's we shake hands, we understand, hey, this is a professional wrestling match. This is not personal. This is business. I want to win. And I think the fans, I think they respect that. They respect the fact that I'm going in there. It's not personal for me. It's strictly, you know, to quote Nick Aldis in the NWA, it's strictly business.
Fair enough. When things like, of course, NWA are about and AWWE, is there any, what's your kind of goals then? What would be your end game? You'd be quite happy if you made it. If you got to that point, you'd be like, I've made it now. I can kind of retire happy kind of thing.
So there's so many layers to that, to be honest with you. The thing that I want to be is I just want to strictly be the best professional wrestler that I can possibly be. Whether that involves me going to a higher level or not remains to be seen. But my goal is to be the best professional wrestler I can be to prove that European wrestling is the best wrestling. That's just my opinion. But individual goals that I've set, I would like to meet those. If I could meet those, then I could, when it comes time for me to hang it up and be done, I can look back and say, you know what? I accomplished what I wanted to accomplish. I did the things that I wanted to do. I can look back happy on it. Obviously, one of those goals is to make it to the European wrestling scene, to wrestle in the UK, to wrestle in Germany. Like you mentioned WXW earlier, I would love to compete there if I get the opportunity. To travel the world and do this. Also, I want to try to leave wrestling in a better place than I found it. And a lot of guys say that. And to be honest, I've got no clue how I'm going to make that happen because you've got so many guys who are already making it a much better place. But I'm going to figure it out. Hopefully, we'll see. But if I can look back, if I can say that I got the best that I could possibly be, I got to travel the world and do this. And really, really do this, not just, you know, go out there and play, but I actually got to do this. I got to wrestle some of the best competitors in the business, and I got to meet some of the greatest people that I've ever got to interact with because, you know, I love wrestling so much is the fact that you meet people from different walks of life. You're not going to meet the same type of person. You're going to meet different people from different backgrounds with different experiences, different beliefs, what have you. And to me, that is absolutely amazing because I love meeting people from different, you know, from that have different experiences than me, that think differently than me, because to me, that diversifies my mind and makes my horizons a little bit broader.
A very well worded answer for that. It seems, yeah, like I said, there's multiple layers to it. I suppose, yeah, as long as you feel like you've accomplished your goal towards the end, I suppose that's all that really matters.
I got to say that I was a professional wrestler. That right there is one of the best things that I could ever say in my life, and I can say that I've done it. So.
So you mentioned, of course, DNA. We mentioned right at the start when I was doing your intro as well. How did the team of Distinguished Noble Aristocrats come about? Were you thrown together and it worked? What was the journey for that?
Well, my tag partner came along about maybe 6-7 months after I started, and he showed up and he walked through the door and I saw him and I was like, oh, okay, this is going to be interesting. And he got told the same thing as me. Look. This is going to hurt. You're going to be tired. You're going to be sore, but we're going to find out if you really want to do this. And he got in there and they put him through every torment you could put through someone. And he didn't stop. He kept going. He stopped one time. He looked at the guy who was running the drills and said, can I stop for a second so I can go throw up? And he did, and he came back, and he kept right on going. I was like, okay, I'm going to get along with this guy. And we just, you know, started off just matching. You know, we never teamed or anything like that. We were just, you know, we were just friends. We got to know each other. And then we were going to a show in Indiana, a show that was having tryouts. And we were going to wrestle each other that night. Well, the next day, we were going to be back in another town in Tennessee. So we went and we did the show in Indiana, completely stunk out the joint because we were both new, didn't know what we were doing. And then we came back to Tennessee and we got there and we got told, hey, it was kind of, you know, a thrown together thing. You guys are going to be doing this new group with another guy. Okay, cool. So we went out there and we did it. And then it clicked for us. And I thought, okay, there's something here. And I asked him, I said, would you like to explore, you know, other further tag options? And he said, yes. And then we got it rolling. We weren't always, you know, the Distinguished Noble Aristocrats or DNA. We started out, our team initially was Merciless. That was the faction that we were in. And we kept that for a while, but I thought, you know, it might be time to make a change. And as I'd said, I was a huge fan of the Midnight Express and teams like that, the Heavenly Bodies. So we came up with Desired and Admired. That was going to be the new tag team name. The week that I put that out on Pro Wrestling Tees, WWE came out with Mandy Rose and Sonya, Fire and Desire. And I thought, there they go. They're stealing my stuff. I thought, okay, I don't want to take a chance on us getting a cease and desist or something like that. I don't want us to get in legal issues. And I also don't want us to get looked at as they're ripping off, you know, the WWE. I don't want that. So we got in front of that and we just abbreviated the name to DNA. And that's what we've been ever since. And then when I got my lordship, I told him, I said, hey, I think we might need to start talking about making some changes. I'm going to elevate you a little bit. And that's where Distinguished Noble Aristocrats came from.
So for a little bit then, it was the old CM Punk thing. What does CM stand for? And it was, no, it's just DNA. That's it.
Yeah.
Until you've decided that's what it is now. That's what it is until we got there in the end. So yeah, you mentioned that, of course, when obviously you say that name, I think, of course, Regal and Eaton when he was Sir Robert and all that kind of stuff. So that kind of all ties back together when you're speaking about your interactions and stories that you've heard about Bobby Eaton. So that kind of all ties up in a nice little bow for that as well. So looking to the future then, I'll ask you, we've got two questions we ask everyone. I don't know if you've listened to any of the podcasts I've done so far, but I've got two questions we ask that are not wrestling related. They're just silly questions that have stayed around for 100 and whatever episodes. The first one is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
That's a hard question, because I've got to go with a classic and say T-Rex.
That's fine. It's a classic answer. Everyone was going, a lot of people pick actual dinosaurs, and very occasionally someone will say something like Rex from Toy Story or just something a bit out there. I'm like, yeah, that's fine.
But Reptar from Rugrats. That's
there you go. That's the one. Go with that. And the other one we ask is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
I'm sorry, you cut out on me a little bit. Say that again.
Right. What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
What kind of fight are we talking about? Because that depends
on that. That's the question. The question is that your imagination can.
Okay. I was always raised with the mindset that there is no such thing as a fair fight. So I'm going to say the sheep because they got the numbers game.
There you go. That's fine. Yeah. I've asked many people that, including Joe Hendry. I had Joe Hendry on the podcast. That's the kind of questions I ask people that are being Ring of Honor. I asked him that, and he was not happy with it. He wanted rules, and he wanted to know what was happening. He wanted to know a bit more information about this cow that's in this fight.
Oh, but I would like to have some kind
of that's the question.
That's the question. So okay, so I'm gonna go with the sheep, because the way I look at it, you got one sheep that can get in front and run his mouth, and the cow's focused on that. Then the second sheep can come in, attack him from behind, and then he's already down on his back. So once you get him down, you can just kind of keep him down. And they just keep pounding on him until it's done. Now, if that cow gets up, they're probably going to have some problems, because cows, you know, because I live in East Tennessee. There's cows all over the place. One of my neighbors has sheep living in his front lawn, I swear to God. So I've seen how big cows can get. So if the cow gets up, they're going to have some problems getting back down again, because it's straight, you know, berserker and can just run through them. But if they get on it from the jump, I'm going to say the sheep.
I love this question. People either take it way too far or they just go sheep and then just move on and that's it over. I love it. That's why it stayed for so long in this question sheet, because it's just a ridiculous question. It is. So as far as like other people that are Scottish working in the US, of course, the ones I've seen or heard of anyway, we've got the Grimy Scots. I'm not sure where they wrestle out of, unfortunately. They're the guys that were arranging to get an interview that was 1 a.m. I was like, no. And the other one was Calder McCall is another one, who wrestled in Scotland for a fair bit in the start of his career. I don't know if you've ever had any interactions with Calder.
I've never interacted with him personally because he lives in Las Vegas, but I am familiar with him. We share each other's stuff on social media. We've had a couple of talks, and I have watched his stuff. That lad is amazing. I will fight him at one point. It will happen. He will probably toss me about and absolutely leather me, but it's going to happen. So, Calder, if you're watching this, talk to who you got to talk to. Get me out to Las Vegas. I'll do the same. I don't know if you want to come to Tennessee, but we're going to get it worked out. Me and you, one-on-one. Put your dukes up, mate.
Costigan, McCall, Rocky Top.
Good God.
I think he's got a sword. He'll be fine.
Well, if he's got a sword, then I will be fine because I've got guns. So no such thing as a fair fight.
I think we've covered quite a bit in our brief time speaking today. We talk about goals, and we mentioned it, but if there is... Question we're trying to end on is your main event at WrestleMania, hypothetically speaking, and you get to pick your opponent. You get to pick the match, so it could be a multi-man match. What would be your choice? So we'll say that it could happen, as in someone who's still active.
Okay. So if it were to happen, these would be. I'm going to give two because it would really depend on where I'm at skill wise by then, and also kind of what the context of it all is. First option would be one of my favorite wrestlers going right now, and that is the Ring General, Walter, just because I love that style of match. Even though it's hard-hitting, you're going to hurt, but it's proper, great European wrestling match, so I love that. So either him or Timothy Thatcher.
Go. Or all three. Why not? Just get 3 years in the ring. Yeah. And I don't think anyone would survive afterwards, but... You know, it's WrestleMania. Thank you very much for taking time to speak to me today. I've learned a lot. Like I say, when we just before I hit record, I didn't have many notes. I didn't have a lot to go with, but I think I've learned quite a lot about yourself, and I'm definitely going to be checking out more of Murphy Costigan in the future as well, because it's always like speaking to someone who's clearly just very passionate about wrestling, and they know what they want, and they're going to do all the work they can to get there as well. If there's anything, any advice you could give to someone that may be thinking about starting out, whether they're in Tennessee or whether they're over here in Scotland, what would be your kind of sage advice that you can give them?
Well, first of all, I'd like to say thank you for having me. I very much appreciate this. This is actually the first podcast I've ever done. So thank you very much for having me. As far as advice, I always try to steer that to more experienced people most of the time. But for new people getting in, as far as like what a base indie scene looks like in Scotland presently, I can't say, I'm not there, but I would say, know what direction you want to go in, commit to that, and then just drive hard on it. Don't stop. If you fall off the wagon, it's okay. Just get back. As long as you get up and get back on. Cause I've fallen off the wagon numerous times. There's been times like, man, I don't know if I want to do this anymore, you know, but then I get myself back up. I dust myself back off and I keep on moving forward. So, always be open to advice from people who have been doing this longer than you, even if it's just someone that you might have never even heard of. You know, you might not know who they are. Listen to what they tell you. You don't have to do it, but you need to at least listen to it and show that proper respect, because I was always brought up with you respect the people that have done the veterans of this business, who the true veterans anyway, that have done this longer than you. You show that proper respect. They critique you. You listen, mouth shut, ears open. I very much subscribe to that theory. If someone's been doing this for a long time, then they tell me, hey, you need to do this. Even if they tell me and I know that's not right at all, I still let them tell me, and then it just in one ear, out the other. But get proper training. Know what you want to go after. Be open to feedback and be humble. And never be afraid to get told, hey, that was absolutely garbage. You suck. But here's what you can do to get better. That's the best thing that you can ever get in professional wrestling is that was god awful, but I'm going to tell you how to get to this next step and how to make that a lot better.
Fantastic. So, thank you very much for joining me. Where can people find you on social media?
Social media, you can find me on Facebook, Murphy Costigan. You can find me on Twitter, even though I sincerely suck at it. But you can find me on Twitter, at Murphy Costigan. And you can find me on Instagram, lord.costigan. Also, you can find me on Pro Wrestling Tees, www.prowrestlingtees.com/Scotland Strong. That's where you can check out all my designs. And as far as if you have questions about other merchandise, places you can find me, you can always shoot me a DM. I'll answer you if I can.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me. Cheers.